Hello, I'm Steve O'Halloran from Asset Labs, and here's my response to the question about check compliance at purchasing. Let me just read a little bit of it here. For any software licensing purchasing, the key question is, am I compliant? I've seen some acquisitions that were not compliant, blah, 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 blah. How to protect ourselves, right? Well, interesting question, and it has been looked at that previously, though I'm going to have to say, difficult answer. One of my first responses is that there should be no questions asked at the purchasing event. The purchasing event should be because the requirements for the entitlements or licenses have exceeded your capacity. Therefore, you will not be compliant unless you buy more entitlements, right? Or something of that nature. Something in your infrastructure has changed, rather, whether it's simple, I have more desktops, or more complex, I've invoked high availability on my within my clusters for my virtualized SQL servers. Like, what? Yeah. So there really should be a determination, not a question, at the purchasing level, right? And okay, even if there isn't. So here's the difficulty, which basically brings me back to hopefully the point I'm trying to make, is what you're really asking for here is based upon an assumption that there is a piece of software and a device that is operating it, and they are intrinsically linked. That's an OEM condition. And so that's rather simple to do. But the problem is when you start talking about preparing a purchasing file with information about infrastructure architecture, which is right here, right? On the basis, like signed by the vendor with compliance guarantees. Well, here's the problem. Like, no vendor is going to sign on guaranteeing compliance based upon that condition. And it's not likely that a consumer, a corporation, will divulge infrastructure architecture to a vendor. And even if they wanted to, the problem is, thanks to virtualization and basically the throwaway concept of hardware these days and multiple usage rights, is that the architecture and the framework itself is extremely fluid and can change from day to day to day. So let's take SQL Server as an example. Microsoft recently converted entitlements from a proc-based to a core-based. So you did buy a proc. So imagine 5-6 years ago buying licenses for SQL Server, right, or Windows Server, or whatever, based upon procs, right? And then Microsoft said, we're doing a conversion. You're now buying cores. Well, you're going to have to record that, right? And there's one of the bigger problems of complexity. The other issue with, let's say, SQL Server is that I could go buy 16 cores of SQL Server Enterprise Edition, or even Standard for that matter. And I could put it, and I can apply it against a virtualized device, right, running a Windows Server. And so, or portions of, so each of them maybe are 4 vCPUs, right? Now, Microsoft recently, you know, changes the dynamics. So you have to buy minimum 4 core licenses in order to establish that. But if you have any more, you can buy it at the host level, right? But it gets even more complex. If your VM administrator decides to turn on high availability, then what it means is that there has to be enough licenses across every single host where every single SQL Server is, right? And so it is a non-linear fluid architecture. Now, the best that the vendors have done to accommodate this is to give you usage rights. The usage rights are part of your license agreement, and the usage rights, as declared when you bought them, if your license is perpetual, are perpetual as well. And so the license rights are basically terms and conditions of how to use it and things in which they have to be interpreted and are not fixed. And a very simple example, Microsoft Office. So let's say you have Office 2013 on a machine and Office 2016 on a machine. Well, if you just bought the retail version of Office 2013 and 2016, you can put them both on your machine and you're fine. You will need 2 separate licenses to do that. But underneath a volume license agreement, you can actually start with 2013, and then let's say underneath the three-year program of enterprise agreement, you're allowed to move up to 2016. You can keep the 2013 on the machine, because let's say we had access, and we don't want to redesign access for 2016. We want to keep it. So you got to keep Office 2016 and 2013. So now you have two different products. But guess what? You don't need the license. The license is covered underneath a greater version, right? See how complex it can get? So again, rolling back, honestly, you should not be asking the question of, am I compliant? You should be purchasing because an existing or potential non-compliancy is going to happen, whether the potential is planned, like we're expanding, we're buying more desktops, or oh my gosh, we turned high availability on, we have to buy a few more core licenses for our backups. Hopefully that helps, but there are really no examples of vendors requesting architecture framework proof, because it moves, and it wouldn't be used anyways. The usage rights are the vehicle in order to give a guideline to the customer to determine by themselves compliance. Hopefully that helps. Cheers. Bye.